The pandemic, for now anyway, has upended the traditional model of higher education, and particularly for residential colleges, as many schools announce plans to charge full tuition while continuing with remote education. Some are questioning what those tuition dollars are actually paying for and if it's worth it. Our Sreenivasan reports now on a new effort to rethink the value and the cost of the traditional four-year experience in the COVID-19 era. His story is part of our Rethinking College series.
Before the pandemic, leaving home and moving into a college dorm was a rite of passage for many young adults.
You have a desk that comes with the room.
I'm just now getting around to posting my dorm room tour.
Some students even took to YouTube to share their campus experiences. But late night pizza runs, the freshman 15, studying on the quad, none of those things can happen easily online.
I really like where I am right now. It's super close to the dining hall and...
Stanford student Cyan Danjou is one of those who enjoyed documenting dorm life and is now missing it.
The residential experience for myself and a lot of students around my age, the first time that we're starting to build new skills, build new relationships, and really have our independence and make decisions for ourselves.
Now, as she heads into her junior year, when most of her classes will be remote, Danjou says she's questioning the value of that educational experience, and she may take some time off.
When we're making this decision whether the tuition we're paying is worth it, yes, the classes are there and they're valuable, but it's about the entire experience. It's about having a diverse class of people, diverse sets of interests that are talking to you. And
while Danjou and many other students around the country are debating how to approach this era of remote learning, there is little debate that getting a four-year degree is generally worth it, with significantly higher lifetime earnings for most. But the cost of those degrees has skyrocketed, roughly doubling over the past several decades, leading to more than $1.6 trillion in national student loan debt. Over the years, those costs and other factors have made the residential college experience inaccessible for many lower income and students of color. So now, in the new COVID era, when so much is being upended in higher education, some are arguing there's no better time to rethink what college looks like after the pandemic.
The model of higher education that we are delivering in the U.S. has been based on this residential experience that cost about twice what an education cost in Europe.
That's Richard Aaron, Dean of the School of Education at the University of California, Irvine. Last September, he and his colleagues began a first-of-its-kind study to try and better understand the value and cost of a four-year liberal arts education, where students often live on or near campus and are exposed to a wide variety of subjects.
We believe that there's something about the residential college experience that is useful for human development and growth for these students, whether that's worth $10,000, $20,000, $40,000 a year, in addition, for 4 years, is an open question.
The study, which is funded by the Mellon Foundation, also a NewsHour supporter, is tracking a diverse cohort of 1,200 UCI students over 3 years to learn how they're learning and what aspects of their education help them to succeed. Aram says that what makes the project so unique is the type of data being collected. About 100 different metrics, ranging from weekly surveys on mental health and stress to tracking time spent in online classes.
I think it's possible, given the complexity of our data, to attempt to get at that.
On a recent afternoon, Aram and his team met virtually to go over new survey results.
62% of the students reported that they do have new responsibilities.
Their early data showed students were less engaged with online studies when they reported the lack of a quiet study space and new family responsibilities at home. That kind of information was immediately helpful for Michael Denon, the university's vice provost for teaching and learning.
That really has to inform how we advise our faculty and how we train them this summer to think about their teaching, because we're not used to thinking about all the other stuff that's going on outside of their courses.
Michelle Cooper is also thinking about the future.
We want colleges and universities to really rethink their business model, rethink how they serve students, and rethink how they deliver and education.
She's the president of the Institute for Higher Education Policy and one of the leaders of a national group now studying the economic and non-economic returns of education after high school. Cooper says there needs to be more awareness that the benefits of a residential college experience were not accessible to everyone.
Social capital that's provided through these sort of traditional brick and mortar residential colleges is something that many people have always known was there, but never really talked about in a very upfront and open way. That is certainly something that we have seen many low-income students struggle with. If you are attending a community college and you kind of, you know, go to school and you go back home or you go to work, like, you don't know where to often go to establish those relationships with individuals who can help you get that leg up in employment.
That was the experience of Walter Ramirez, who became the first in his family to graduate from college in June. He spent several years at a community college before transferring to UC Irvine and living on campus. He says the connections he made there have given him a big boost as he prepares to enter the workplace.
At UC Irvine, I learned how to, you know, talk to professors and work with them on a research project or ask if I could assist them with a research project. And that's how I started building relationships with professors. And eventually they began to support me with letters of recommendation for scholarships or internship opportunities or even job applications.
For his part, Richard Arum says he hopes his study will help students and colleges better understand what aspects of the residential college experience are important to preserve and what could be tweaked to bring down costs and expand access, issues that are more relevant than ever.
It's quite likely that the economy that comes out of this crisis is going to look structurally different than the one we started with. The post-secondary system is going to be responsible not just for educating the same number of students we have in the past, but dramatically more students. We need to experiment. We need to innovate to ensure workforce development and economic competitiveness for our society.
Arum and his team plan to release initial results from their study in the fall. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Hari Sreenivasan.